the people who are most self-assured, most confident, who stand in their power, are the people who don't need to pull out their sword and assert their dominance. It's the people who don't need to flex the muscles and talk about how great they are.
What's up, everybody? Welcome back to another episode of the Go Get It podcast. Stig, how you doing, man?
I am doing very well. It's been a busy weekend. Just got back to New York after a few days in Arlington, Virginia, doing some video work down there, seeing some friends, and just traveled back. It was like a 6-hour journey back from DC to New York, right here into the Brooklyn apartment to do a late night, Sunday night, Go Get It pod recording, and I couldn't be happier to be here.
Right on, man. Awesome. Well, before we jump into today's episode, we're going to be doing another listener question episode coming up pretty shortly here. So go ahead and drop your questions into us because we would love to answer them on the next listener question episode. And in order to do that, you can give us a call at 707-595-0071. That will bring you to a voicemail where you can record your question. Don't be shy. Jump in. Give us your questions. Do not be shy. And with that, let's jump into today's episode, which we're calling Put Down Your Sword. And in it, Austin is going to share a story that taught him about what it means to be truly self-assured and what it means to stand in your power. So let me pass it off to my man, Austin Stigmeyer. Take it away, bro.
Thank you, Hunt. Well, this story goes back about a week now, and Hunter, you were actually there for it. We were sitting right next to each other at your house in New Jersey. It seems like forever ago, and it's always so sweet when we're together. So I remember this memory as fondly as I do all the memories when we're together. And this happened at HQ, at the HQ, at the headquarters. That's right, the Go Get It Pod headquarters. This story happened while we were watching American Idol, which, for those who don't know, I actually auditioned for this I always say this American Idol because it looks like This American Life. I actually auditioned for American Idol this year, did a live Zoom audition with American Idol producers. But unfortunately, in the final seven, I was watching from home with Hunter and not on that stage.
Austin, just for the viewers to know his little background here, Austin plays the mandolin, also is a great singer, has performed at weddings before. He's got some talent. We're going to have to, you know, maybe maybe one of the listener questions will be like, can you play a song for us? Or,
wow.
You know, you never know. Maybe somebody listening wants to hear your skills.
That would be something. I would love that. If someone wants to call it in, I'm not going to hold back. I will break out the mando and play some tunes for you all if you want to hear it.
Right on.
But Hunter and I were sitting on the couch. His parents are nearby. And we're watching American Idol Top 7. And each week on American Idol, they have some sort of theme. Last week was a Disney theme. Sometimes it's like, you know, a rock and roll theme. Or could be any sort of thing. And when I was at Hunter's house this past week, the theme of the show was Coldplay. So every person who was in the top seven had to choose a Coldplay song, and they played that song on the main stage where America would then vote who they want to see go through. And each week, along with a theme, there is also a mentor or someone who is coaching each of the finalists how to knock their song out of the park. And because it was Coldplay week, the mentor was Chris Martin, who is the lead singer of Coldplay. So each participant, we're talking kids who are 15 years old to, I think the oldest participant might have been 25 or something like that. Youngsters, ambitious musicians. Each of them chose their Coldplay song. And Hunter and I watched as each one of these people came up to Chris Martin and talked to him about what song they chose, and they would play the arrangement of the Coldplay song. And then Chris Martin would respond. And Hunter and I were floored in this moment because we watched Chris Martin every single time someone came to him and played his song, the amount of energy that he was giving to build that person up and encourage them, even when someone completely changed the arrangement of his song, which was so successful, Chris Martin would be like, oh, you're doing it better than I did. You're doing it better than I could ever do. And he was just so supportive. And Hunter and I were just watching because we were taken aback, I think, by watching someone who is so successful not ever assert how successful he is. Not once did he explicitly talk about himself, talk about how successful he is, talk about how good the song is that he wrote. All he did was welcome these people into the room and lift them up and encourage them on their way to performing his song. Anything you want to add there, Hunt?
Nah, he was amazing. And I know that, I love Coldplay. I love their songs. One of their songs is our favorite, which is Orphans. And like, I love them. I love this dude so much more now. Like, just seeing like how he was as a person and how he helped these people. He had no ego whatsoever. Super humble guy, very genuine. I mean, that's the kind of things when you see that, you're like, that's the man right there.
And what is really interesting is we were about halfway through the show and Hunter actually looked at me and was like, who is that guy?
Yeah.
You didn't even realize for a while that he was the lead singer of Coldplay because he didn't talk about himself at all. It was easy to miss that. And what this whole episode and us watching Chris Martin do that, what that reminded me of is a conversation that we had with your brother Jason about a year and a half ago. This was one of our monthly...
Our brother Jason.
Our brother Jason, that's exactly
That's a Matt
right.
Kamenetz correction right there. Shout out to Matt Kamenetz.
That's right. It reminded me of something that he said to me about a year and a half ago on one of our monthly calls. And we were talking in the context of someone who had kind of put me down and I was feeling down about it. And someone who kind of had, I would say, kind of gone out of their way to put me down. And it just had me feeling sad. And I remember Jason saying this. He said, security and power always comes from a place of never having to say anything. The powerful warrior isn't the one who pulls out their sword. It's the person who never touches their sword and just stands there because they know they don't need to unless they really need to. There is no offensive show. I went back in the archives because Hunter and I record every one of our monthly calls, and we have an episode about the call if you want to go back into the archives and listen to that. I went back and listened to this recording from Jason where he's talking about power, where he's talking about status, and essentially saying the people who are most self-assured, like Chris Martin, the people who are most self-assured, most confident, who stand in their power, are the people who don't need to pull out their sword and assert their dominance. It's the people who don't need to flex the muscles and talk about how great they are. And it got me thinking, how often do we see someone, you know, posting on social media about how great they are, what their accomplishments are? How often do you see people in business, in life, put other people down, bringing out that sword and cutting people down as a way of signaling how powerful they are? Jason was so right in that moment. power, confidence, and self-assuredness is when you never feel like you need to pick up your sword and assert your dominance. And this was what was running through my head when we watched American Idol and Chris Martin never feel like he needed to cut anyone down, never feel like he needed to assert his own dominance. All he did was stand in his power by shining a light on others and being there for them. And I think that is so cool and something that I really want to strive for because, yeah, sure, Chris Martin is at like the top of the top, but I don't think you need to be at the top of the top to have this mindset of like, I don't need to flex to assert status. What can be much more powerful is if you don't draw the sword and are just confident in who you are, where you are right now. Hunt, talk to me a little bit about this moment and what that's bringing up for you as we go through it.
Yeah. Now that there's a great quote by Teddy Roosevelt, speak softly, carry a big stick. It's like no bluff, you know? And I think there's someone who comes to mind with this in this particular example is a ex-teammate of mine. When I was playing New York Cosmos 2015, we acquired Raul. And for anyone who doesn't know, well, first of all, you know, anybody that's referred to by just one name means they're a baller. but if anyone who doesn't know Raul is one of the greatest all-time players in the sport of soccer. He was the captain of Real Madrid, which is one of the biggest clubs in the history of the game. His resume is beyond normal. And he was a guy who spoke softly but carried a big stick. Rarely drew his sword. Always kind of took everything in. And then every once in a while, when he would lay his opinion down, it was like it carried a more significant weight because he wasn't drawing his sword so often. He wasn't having to try to prove to people who he was or how successful he was or how much he can help or whatever it was. He really picked and chose his moments. And you can tell, like, when people noticed that, right? When we were listening, when we were watching American Idol, like, the impact that he had on us when we were watching was profound. Mm-hmm. And I think you're exactly right. You don't have to be Raul and one of the greatest players of all time to be able to have that impact. You just need to be self-assured. You need to be confident in yourself that what you're doing is, you know, in due time will attract any kind of significance you're trying to gain or make the impact that you're trying to make. And just stay true to that and stick to that. Because I know there's so many moments, we both deal with this as well, right? Like, you want to do so well, you want to make a high impact, you want to be significant, and you want to go out and grab the attention and be like, look at me, look at all the great things that I'm doing. And oftentimes it's, you know, it takes the reverse of that to get what you're seeking, right? Somebody else notices the amazing things that you're doing. And then the one time that you do speak on it or about it, it has so much more influence and impact than constantly, you know, striving for that attention.
That is interesting right there, Hunt, because you're actually, you know, you're highlighting a very specific tactic in which you saw Raul do this, which is that when you were in the locker room with him or everyone was ushering out an opinion, he was one of the last, if not the last, to speak. It's funny because it reminds me of just a dinner I had a few nights ago where someone showed up to this dinner. And they were, let's just say, quite a loud and confident person. And I remember leaning over to someone near me in the first 5 minutes of this dinner. I said, like, wow, that person's quite confident. And then by the end of the night, I realized, you know what? I think there's a good chance that they are not. Because I watched for 3 hours as this person completely dominated the conversation, completely dominated the room. Oh, you got something. You got something.
And I got because what I'm thinking about, I'm literally where I'm taken to the place that you're describing right now in the situation.
Yeah, yeah.
And it's like in the moment, in that dinner, in that 3-hour dinner, that person probably feels like the most confident person, and people are kind of maybe like you are sensing that they're a confident person. But in reality,
right,
when everybody walks away from that dinner, they're like, what a tool. This guy just blasted at me for the last 3 hours. You know, like I hated that. I don't want to be around that. I don't want to follow person. You know,
I think what we're getting at is so much right now, because of how busy everything is, because of how much noise there is in the world, people feel a need to shout to be heard. People need to shout or feel this need to shout to be seen. And the thing that Chris Martin was displaying, what Jason told us in that moment, is you don't need to shout to be heard. You just need to be that Yoda-like figure who's taking in information, processing it, and speaking when it is your moment to add something. You don't need to raise the volume to be a leader. And maybe that is you. Maybe you are a very outgoing and loud person by nature. But I think there is such a pull today to feel like we need to do that. And as I watch
even in that case, it comes down to picking your moment, like you said.
Yeah.
Right? And that actually reminds me, so something I've been thinking of as you've been speaking for the past couple, you know, as we've been speaking for the past couple minutes, is a speech that Simon Sinek gives. And it's very applicable to what we're talking about here and could put some of this into context. Simon Sinek, for those of you that don't know, he's a great author. He has some of his interviews that he's done online they're quoted as like the best speech ever or the best interview ever. And he wrote a book called Leaders Eat Last. And then subsequently he was doing a speaking engagement that I had seen, and he talks about how he goes into these businesses all the time to see what the culture is like and who the leaders are and how they are leading their people and whether they're effective leaders or not. And he says that one of the most important qualities that a leader should practice is speaking last. And he says that does two things, right? He lays out an example where he says, you know, CEO of the company comes in. He says, listen, this is what I think needs to happen. This is where we're going to go. And then after that, he goes to get the opinion of all the other people. But he says, you've already lost the game. And he said, the best leaders, they let everybody else speak. And then they speak last for two reasons. Number one, because in that situation, everybody else speaking makes them feel heard, makes them feel important, makes them feel significant and worthy, and as if they're contributing to the success of whatever it is that the company is trying to do. And then number two, because now they know when you speak last, you know what everybody else is thinking. You have all of that additional information and inputs to be able to give you a better judgment when rendering your opinion. And he said the best leaders that he sees, they practice the habit of speaking last. And he describes how it sounds simple, but it is not easy to do. You have to, you know, at times bite your lip, listen, take in all the information, and then ultimately, you know, deliver what it is you want to deliver at precisely the right time. And ultimately, you know, that's gonna go over a lot better, at least in my opinion it is. That's something that when I heard him talk about this, it's something that I deliberately started to practice in my own life, in situations, even when it's not business situations, even when it's social situations, and you're just going out to dinner or whatever, and there's so many moments where I'm like, oh, I want to jump in there, and I just kind of remind myself, like, no, let them take the floor, let them get all their ideas out there, because maybe there's more in there that, you know, I want to peel back the layers to, so that might change a little bit about what I'm going to say, and just exhibiting some of that restraint. And I think it's, yeah, it's helped me a lot as a person and even as a leader in some of the teams that I'm a part of.
I love that. And I think what we watch Chris Martin do and the CEOs that this Synect is talking about who would actually do this, when they're firing on all cylinders, it's not that they just listen to everyone and then say their idea. What the best leaders who I've been mentored by or led by, and I count you as one of those when you were definitely like the captain at Stanford Soccer, it's the people who will hear what others have to say, hear the gifts that other people are bringing to the table, and incorporate those things into what they're proposing to the group. So for example, like Chris Martin, again, building up people who come into his space with their song, with their rendition of his song. And he says, ooh, I love what you did there. Now let me take that and enhance it. Let me help you enhance what you've already got right there. This is what you're bringing to the table and I can see it. Let me help prop that up. It's the same thing for the leaders you're talking about. They're not the ones who come into the room pulling out their sword and saying, hey, do this, do this, do this, do this. I am the dominant one in this room. They're sitting back listening to everyone else, and then they're doing that yes and improv tactic of building on the ideas of others so that everyone feels as a team like they're contributing to the forward motion. I think that's so cool.
Yeah. There's also, there is a fine line there as well though on the, like, you know, sometimes, and it depends on the setting. I think in the ideal, you're exactly correct, but there are settings where it's like, if you take everybody's, you know, everybody's opinion and kind of volley everything that everybody's saying, sometimes it could get crazy and go haywire and all over the place.
Right.
But in general, I think, like we touched on, when people get to voice their opinion and they feel part of that process and that their input is taken into account, I think oftentimes that's the baseline of something that's really important to have happen there.
Absolutely. And that is going to take us to our Go Get It Challenge of the Week. Right before we jump into the Go Get It Challenge of the Week, I just want to emphasize and highlight here what we're talking about is redefining what power and self-assuredness looks like. It doesn't always have to be screaming over the noise. And so this week with your Go Get It Challenge, we want you to find a moment this week where you are tempted to jump in and assert your opinion and see what happens if you don't touch the sword. See what happens if you let everyone else speak and then you follow, you listen, take in information, let other people have the floor, and then speak last. Don't shout over the noise. Let the noise pass, and then you lead.
Absolutely. And this is just like anything else, this is a habit that you're going to have to practice over time. And first recognizing the moments where it's applicable and then putting it into practice. So I think this is awesome. If you love what you're hearing here, if you're thinking of somebody who, you know, you're like, oh, they would definitely love to hear this episode, go ahead and share it with your friends, with your family. If you're listening on one of the podcast channels, we also put these up on YouTube. So if you want to get these every single week pinged to you, just go ahead and subscribe to the YouTube channel, Hunter Austin. And for this week, everybody, remember, go get it.
Go get it, folks.